could sing it then, I could sing it now. 'Cause who he was is who he is beyond the shadow of a doubt. I might be standing in this darkness with trouble all around, but if I could sing it then, I can still sing it now. Oh, it's not always easy to join those melodies, but how sweetly they remind me of what I still believe. A voice that's raised in times like these might be the truest praise, 'cause I've never been forsaken, and that will never change. And if I could sing it then, I could sing it now. 'Cause who he was is who he is beyond the shadow of a doubt. I might be standing in this darkness with trouble all around, but if I could sing it then, I can still sing it now. Great is our faithfulness, a mighty fortress is our God, standing on the promises. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. And if I could sing it then, I can sing it now. 'Cause who he was is who he is beyond the shadow of a doubt. I might be standing in this darkness with trouble all around, but if I could sing it then, I can still sing it now. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
Open your Bibles, if you will, tonight to Luke chapter number 6. Luke chapter number 6 tonight is where we're going to be. I want to say to all of you, to those of you that were not here on Sunday night, I am planning, and you'll help us to be able to speed up this process. We are planning to be able to have everyone do the spiritual test, the spiritual gifts test. So I have the actual test, and I have the answer sheet to be able to give you, for you to be able to take it, bring it back to us as soon as possible. We're going to do this through about 4 or 5 weeks. Of course, this upcoming week, Brother Patrick's going to be gone. And so I'll cover 2 or 3 chapters within that and cover some ground so we understand. You say, why are we doing that? Well, it's twofold. Number one, if you know what your spiritual gift is off the cuff, typically you just focus on how to be able to master your spiritual gift. The beauty of it is to be able to learn what everybody, what they're able to be able to do, what the spiritual gifts are, and then you're able to be able to learn what yours is specific because of the test. The second side of it is once you give the right amount of attention to everything equally, you would be surprised how much you will learn of other people when you figure out what their spiritual gift is and it's not yours or the same as what yours is. And because when you begin to see how diverse we really are and how the things happen, you realize why some people act the way they act, why they speak the way they speak, why they do the way they do, why they're not as passionate about some things that you are. It's not because they don't love Jesus and because they're out of the will of God. It's just sometimes their spiritual gift is different. We're all different, but we have the same Lord, and all God's people said, amen. Luke chapter number 6, you love Jesus, say amen. Tonight, this is probably one of the most convicting in somewhat sense when I think about this. In Luke chapter number 6, you're going to see in a moment that God tells us how we can receive. He don't really tiptoe about it. So many people say, well, I'd like to be able to receive from the Lord. Well, the Lord makes it very plain how he will give back and he can bless you. But you understand that God gives a promise, but there is a condition. The condition must always be met by us. It's always met by us. We always think that we deserve something, but at the end of the day, God's not just a genie in a bottle. He's not just the old person that you just say, this is what I need, and all of a sudden God gives it to you. No, there's something that you must do in obedience. I want to read a number of verses, so if you could bear with me tonight. It's going to take a few minutes just to be able to kind of get through these, but I think you need to see it because it's everything in context. We're starting in verse number 27 tonight. That's where we're going to be, Luke chapter number 6. Jesus speaking, but I say unto you, which hear, love your enemies, do good to them which hate you. Bless them that curse you, and pray for them which despitefully use you. And unto him that smiteth thee on one cheek, offer also the other. And him that taketh away thy cloak, forbid not to take thy coat also. Give to every man that asketh of thee, and of him that taketh away thy goods, ask them not again. And as ye would that men should do to you, do ye also to them likewise. For if ye love them which love you, what thank have ye? For sinners also love those that love them. And if you do good to them which do good to you, what thank have ye? For sinners also do even the same. And if ye lend to them whom ye hope to receive, what thank have ye? For sinners also lend to sinners and receive as much again. But love ye your enemies and do good and lend, hoping for nothing again, and your reward shall be great, and ye shall be the children of the Highest, for he is kind unto the unthankful and to the evil. Be ye therefore merciful, as your Father also is merciful. Judge not, and ye shall not be judged. Condemn not, and ye shall not be condemned. Forgive, and ye shall be forgiven. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Give, becoming good measure, pressed down and shaken together, running over, shall men give unto your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. And he spake a parable unto them. Can the blind lead the blind? Shall they not both fall into the ditch? The disciple is not above his master, but everyone that is perfect shall be as his master. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but perceivest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Either how canst thou say to thy brother, brother, let me pull out the mote that is in thine eye, when thou thyself beholdest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Thou hypocrite, cast out first the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to pull out the mote that is in thy brother's eye. For a good tree bringeth forth not corrupt fruit, neither doth a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. For every tree is known by his own fruit. For of the thorns men do gather figs, nor a bramble bush gather they grapes. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good. And an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For out of the abundance of the heart his mouth speaketh. And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Whosoever cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doeth them, I will show you to whom he is like. He is like a man which built a house and diggeth deep and laid a foundation on a rock. And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently upon the house and could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock. But he that heareth and doeth not is like a man that without a foundation built a house upon the earth, against which the stream then beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and ruin of that house was great. You look this way. It's a lot of Bible here. You're able to be able to see it lay out. Loving your enemies, how to treat them, judging one another, the tree, the good, the bad, all these different things. And then the foundation, of course, all these things tied together. But there's something that's in this text that you got to be able to conclude or bring all of it together to be able to see. And here's the key that you have to see tonight is this, is the life that we live is made up of choices. It's a choice that you must make for yourself and that I must make for myself as well. And as we think about the measure of the blessings of God and the goodness of God and the things of God in our life, then we must know that it's not by accident. It's not because God owes us something. No, there is a choice that you must make. And listen to me, the choices you make will either bring you consequences, because you could choose your sin. But you cannot choose your consequences. And that's not by man, it's not by church, it's not by religion. Now every knee shall bow. Every one of us will give an account before God one day for our life. Every one of us. So we can pick the sin. We have the choice. Why? Because God's not going to force you. And this is the reason. Because God don't send anybody to hell. Nobody. It's your choice. You say, how do you see that, Brother Jason? I want you to notice what the Bible says. Notice, if you will, in verse number 27. But I say unto you which hear. So that means everyone is hearing what's being said. But then he ties it together in the last two verses that we read. Notice what he says in verses number 48 and 49. He says, but he is like a man which built a house. Who is this man? It's the man in verse number 47, whosoever cometh to me and heareth my sayings. So the same man that hears in 27 and hears in 47, and then notice in 47, and doeth them, this man is a blessed man. But watch me now. The same man spoke, and in the same company another man heard. So he heard in verse number 27. And then again, he hears in verse number 49, but verse 49, the difference is this. The man in 47, he did what was said to do, but the Bible says in verse number 49, but he that heareth and doeth not. So you must understand it's a choice that is in your life. Everything is based on the choices that is in your life specifically. It leads me to another truth that you see here. So there's two outcomes. What are the outcomes? Notice, if you will, in verse number 35, the Bible says this, but love ye your enemies and do good. There it is. Do good. And lend, hoping for nothing again. Watch this now. And your reward shall be great. So it's fair to say that if you do what the Bible says, if you do what God says, then according to verse number 35, there is great reward that you can expect. But I want you to notice what the Bible says in verse number 49. But he that heareth and doeth not is like a man that is without a foundation, built a house upon the earth, against the stream, did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell. Notice these words, and the ruin of that house was great. So as sure as you see a man that is obedient, a woman that is obedient has and can expect great reward in verse number 35, you see in verse number 49 that somebody that does not do what is told to them to do, that there is a great ruin. So the question is this, is what can you expect in your life? Because you cannot fool God. Whatsoever man soweth, he's going to reap those things. And we understand the Bible teaches that. God is not mocked. So you can't just make something up and put on a show and act like everything's fine because some see it and some don't. Some people may never see it, but God always sees it. And you and I may get away with it for a day, but there's going to come a day where we won't. Because the Bible says, not the preacher, not Brother Jason, not your mama, not your daddy, no. The Bible says that when you are disobedient, obedient to God, you can never expect great reward, but you can expect great ruin. When? I don't know. So it leads us to something that's very clear in this text. He's talking about obedience. He's talking about disobedience.
And obedience and stewardship is what? It's great reward. Disobedience and stewardship is what? Is great ruin. So again, we're not even talking about money. We're talking about your life. We're talking about time. We're talking about your words. We're talking about your children. We're talking about your marriage. We're talking about your life, how you live, who you live for. Everything that's in your life that God has blessed you with, including your own life itself, how you live and what you do with it will even determine whether you have great reward or great ruin in your life. So the Bible's teaching here. Not only that, but I want you to be able to notice that he teaches this, that there is things that we can be able to see because of verse number 38. He says, notice, he says, give and it shall be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give into your bosom. For, watch this now, with the same measure that ye meet with all, it shall be measured to you again. He is teaching us also that we're going to be giving, but you're going to be giving, and as you give, it will also be given back to you. Can I tell you this? God will never leave you stranded, and God will never honor. It'll never be a place where he will not honor, is a better way to say that. God will never come to a place where he will not honor the way that you sacrifice and surrender everything that you give to him. God will always bless you. God will always bless your marriage. He'll always bless your children. He'll always bless your home. Now, it might not be necessarily the finest things of everything that you need in life, but I would dare say this, it's great reward. Why? Because God said so, and that is the life that we desire. So what does it look like? What's it require for me to be able to have this great reward in my life? What does it really look like? What does God expect of me for me to have great reward? I want you to notice a few things tonight. Number one, you write this down, what our Lord requires, what our Lord requires. It starts back in verse number 27. He goes down. He's very specific. He don't tiptoe about these things, but it's all about behavior. It's all about behavior. Let me just say this before I dive in it. It's fair to be able to say this. You can't act the way you want to act and just say, well, that's just who I am. No, that's not who God saved you to be. He saved you so that one day in sanctification and every day that it would be more Christ-like every single day of your life. So if you're still playing that role, what you're doing is, forgive me for saying it this way, you are literally almost just smacking God in the face or just living your life the way that you want to. You are your own God, if you want to be able to say it this way, because you're just living for self and that's all that matters. He did not save you for you to be the same. So he says, it's going to require for you to be able to be this person that God has saved you and called you to be, you must watch your behavior. Notice the first thing that he says. Verse number 27. Hard. But I say unto you, which hear, love your enemies. Love your enemies and what? And do good to them that hate you. Now, I don't know about you, but that's a hard thing because right now I could stay here and sit here and you could think about your enemies, the people that you hate, the people that you've said that you've hated. Maybe you didn't hate them, but they get on your nerves and every time you see them, they frustrate you, they hurt you, they've hurt your family, they've caused turmoil, they're always an aggravation, a frustration. And you say, be careful how you laugh about it and make jokes about it. Because the Bible says you ought to love your enemy. Love your enemy. That's what the Bible says. It says that you don't go back after them. You don't try to hurt them. Watch this now. You don't treat them the way that they treated you. There ought to be something different about you. Even your enemies will treat you wrong, but you must treat them different. There ought to be something different about you. Why? Because you're a child of God. You're a Christian. You're a born-again believer. So when they look at you, they don't see an enemy. They see somebody that is submitted to the Holy Ghost, and they wonder, how in the world can somebody act like that? Only the Holy Ghost can give you the power to do that. We preach so much about the working of the Holy Spirit. This is why the Holy Spirit matters. This is why we ought not to quench the Holy Spirit. This is why we ought not to grieve the Holy Spirit. This is why it matters, all these things that people talk about sometimes in our life. Anything that quenches or grieves the Holy Spirit in your life, you needed to get it out of your life quickly. Why? Because you need the power of the Holy Spirit to love your enemies. Can I get an amen? I know the people that come against me. Sometimes it's a whole lot more than what Jason Holly can muster up, if you understand what I mean by that. But the Bible says you got to love your enemies. Notice he keeps going. He says, not only do you love your enemies, but verse number 28, he says, bless them that curse you. Bless them that curse you. Oh, my. So you mean to tell me those people that hurt me with their words, the people that say things that cause destruction in my life, they tear me down, they sow discord, they put me in a place of failure and fault. You're telling me that that I've got to be able to do something that's beyond who I am, yet bless them, the Bible says. In other words, you speak well of them. You do good to them. That's what the Bible says. These are the people that curse you. You want the blessing of God, you got to do it God's way. It didn't say it was fair. It didn't say it feels good. There ain't nothing that says, you know, well, you just got to get over yourself. No, it's going to hurt. You want to know why? Because we still live in this flesh. As long as you live in this flesh, as much as we don't think we do, we deal with pride every single day in our life. And sometimes we don't want to treat those people good when they hurt us and they hurt our family, they hurt our children. We don't want that. But the Bible says that you must bless those people that curse you. He does not say make it right. He doesn't say prove them wrong. He doesn't say put them in their place. He doesn't say be passive aggressive. Somebody help me preach. No, he says bless them. He says bless them. Notice what he says out there. Pray for them. Notice what? Notice pray for them that what? Despitefully use you. These people, they take advantage of you, and the easy thing is to be able to turn around and be able to have revenge and be able to use you. You know, you want to make even. You want to make right. Even. Apples for apples. Oranges for oranges. No. Listen, the best thing you can do is leave it in God's hands and let God take care of every bit of it. You pray for them. You know what I've learned? It's hard to be mad at somebody that you pray for. You say, no, I've been praying for them for a long time. No, you've been asking God to be able to change them a long time. You ain't been praying for them. There's a difference. Y'all help me preach tonight now, friend. I've been here. I understand. It hurts. These wounds cut deep sometimes. And you say, No, we pray. Lord, fix them. Change them. Make them suffer the way. No. We need to pray for them according to the way God would have us pray for them. That's what the Bible says. So notice, he don't just say pray for them. He don't just say bless them. He don't just say love them. But then notice what the Bible says right after that. Verse number 29. He says, and unto him that smiteth thee on one cheek, offer the other. What? And to him that taketh, notice, and him that taketh away the cloak, forbid not to take that cloak also. Did you see what it said? He says, notice, he says, and him that smiteth thee on one cheek, offer him the other. In other words, write this down. What the Lord requires is for you to what? To refuse to attack them. Refuse to attack them. You got to make your mind up. I'm not going to render evil for evil. I'm not going to do this back. No, listen, whatever it takes. Why? Because Jesus, the Bible says, I mean, we love Jesus. Hallelujah. We come to the church on Easter. We're like, hallelujah, praise God. Can I say this? It's amazing, and I'm saying this very carefully, okay? It's borderline hypocritical that we worship this Savior, and we say we want to be like Him, but when people treat us the way that they treated Him, we get mad about it. I mean, you want to be like Jesus, you got to make your mind up. Listen, it's not about me. It's not about me. The way you beat me, the way you hurt me, the way you come against me, the way you bring this against my life and my name, it's not about me. No, it's about God's glory. That's what matters. And that's why Jesus took all the mocking and all the beating, and you could not recognize him because he was not about him. He was about his Father's business. That's what the Bible says. And if we want to be able to see great reward and not great ruin in our life, we must know that position of a servant, you must make yourself of no reputation, is what the Bible says when talking about Jesus Christ, our Lord. Make yourself of no reputation, and only in that moment can you submit yourself where you do not respond and try to attack those who attack you. Can I say this again? That's the work of the Holy Spirit. Notice what he says after that. He says, if a man what? Notice verse number 29. He said, he taketh away thy cloak, forbid not to what? To take thy coat also. In other words, surrender your possessions. Be willing to be able to take it. Listen, don't attack, but surrender. Give everything. Don't just let him take something. Give everything. Be willing to give it all. Whatever it is that he needs, let's give him all. There's nothing that belongs to you. Anything that it takes for them to see Jesus in you, you ought to be willing to give it up. And if that means biting your tongue and walking away, then absolutely that's what it means. Whatever it is, if that means them sitting at that, well, they ain't going to talk to me like that, well, you tell the Bible that. Hey, preach on, preacher. Listen, because we all deal with this. We all deal with this. And I can promise you, you can flip that switch and it's over, friend. And I understand all of that, but God don't get the glory out of that. And if we want this blessed life and we want our family to be blessed, and I don't want my son to be a brawler like I was, and I don't want my son to have a temper like I did, then I can't live like Jason in front of him. I have to submit myself, and I have to be willing to be able to say, I cannot respond the way I want to respond. I cannot talk the way I want to talk, because I don't want him to live with the same enemy and the same, if I could say it this way, the same demon for all of my life that I dealt with. So the only way to do it for him to see Jesus in me is to humble myself right here. Why? Because he needs to see the Lord. Notice what it says. He says, give it to him. Notice after that, verse number 30. He says, give to every man that asketh of thee, and of him that taketh away thy goods, ask them not again. He says, give everything, give whatever it may be. In other words, practice, as one man said, I think it's Don Siss here, this, practice giving living. Whatever it is, just giving living, whatever it takes, giving living. Speaking of that, same thing. That's what it takes. Talking about making peace with people and not being one to attack and surrender and everything. Now, the Bible says in the book of Matthew, when Jesus was preaching the Sermon on the Mount, he said, blessed are the peacemakers, not the peacekeepers, but the peacemakers. Well, you know what we need? We need some people that's going to be peacemakers. When the world's going crazy and people's going crazy and the church is going crazy and everybody's mad at everybody, arguing about stuff over politics and about money and about all the things that's going on. Yes, I understand. I understand things are crazy sometimes. But blessed are the peacemakers. Somebody stand up for Jesus and humble themselves so that everything can kind of be, unplugged a little bit or unraveled a little bit. We don't need everybody trying to cause contention all the time. Amen. Notice verse number 31. He said, as ye would that men should do to you, watch this now, do ye also to them likewise. For if ye love them which love you, what thank have ye? For sinners also love those that love them. You notice what he says? He said, do that likewise. But did you notice what he said right there? Notice, if you will, in the text, he said, What thank have ye? In other words, what mercy is it? You ought to be the one. That's why I wrote down. Make the first move. Make the first move. You ought to be the one that leads that. You ought to be the one that leads the way when it comes to that. You ought to be the one that, when everybody else, as you would that men should do to you. Did you understand what he said right there? As you would that men should do to you. So in other words, the way that you think men should do to you, you don't treat them the way they treat you. You treat them the way that you think they should treat you. In other words, sometimes you got to be the first one to say, I'm sorry when you ain't wrong. You got to be the first one to be able to swallow your pride and walk away and understand that sometimes people don't understand everything. And you can't argue with somebody that's irrational. And that don't just go for the world. That goes in your marriage. You want a blessed marriage? You better keep your mouth shut. Amen. Sometimes we arguing and fighting and all these other different things that's going on. No, we got to treat them. So I don't deserve that. He ain't going to talk to me. She ain't going to talk to me like that. Well, the Bible says you be the first one to set the pattern. There's no exemptions. No excuses. Well, I do better than she does, or I do better than he does. Well, at least I ain't doing that to them, or blah, blah. No, we don't compare ourselves to ourselves. The Bible says Jesus, God himself, literally says, if you want a blessed down, pressed down, running over. Everybody wants that running over marriage. That what? I mean, we're talking about stewardship, the measure, giving it back. God, I want a good marriage. I want a good family. I want a good church. Well, be the example. Be the one that you want to see throughout the church. Be the spouse that you need in your marriage. Be that person, not because they treat you that way, not because they're perfect. Perfection only belongs to God. It don't belong to you, and it don't belong to them. It ain't about who's better and who's worse. I promise you this. Somebody's always better and somebody's always worse at something, and vice versa in something else. Amen. The problem is we're always sitting around just saying, well, that's not it. I don't have to do that. Yes, you do. And listen, I could take that in context for anything when it comes to friends, when it comes to family, when it comes to marriage, when it comes to children. I don't need the book of Peter chapter number 3 to be able to tell where wives should submit themselves and put on. That's what the Bible says, as an ornament. So that means you got to choose to be able to do it with your conversation. Yeah, I don't even need that verse. This verse right here is sufficient. Be the example that you're supposed to be. Right here. Whatever you think, you be it. You say, well, what's it, Jesus? Jesus, you need to know, okay, forgive, love your enemies, bless those that curse you, pray for those that despitefully use you, smite thee on one, offer them the other cheek. I mean, it's already in the text. All you got to do is go backwards, go backwards, go backwards, and read it. He makes it plain. The example in our life is not one another. It's not the preacher. It's not the friends. It's not the senior saints. No, it's Jesus himself. This is our behavior, and this is what the Bible says that the Lord requires of us. Notice what he said there in that verse 32. I like that. He says, for if you love them which love you. So in other words, if you just do what's expected. Did you read that? It was said that a couple of times. If you lend to them who we hope to receive. So in other words, if you're only good to those who love you, if you're only good to those who give to you, notice what he says. He says, what thank have ye? In other words, what are you really showing that's evidence of your life? Because a good person that's not saved would do that. Everybody all right? You don't have to be saved to love somebody who loves you. You don't have to be saved to lend to somebody who's going to give back to you and bless you. No, you just be a good person. Be a person of integrity. Be a person of character. You know, you marry anybody and get along. Somebody help me now. Right? That's not what he said, though. He said, "What thing?" In other words, that's nothing. Watch me now. And why applaud yourself because that's all you do? You know, the Bible says for a man to be able to go a mile, he should go twain. Oh, we've preached on that. We understand that. Can I tell you what? That first mile is reasonable service. That's Romans chapter number 12, verse number 1 and 2. That extra mile is where they see that you really love the Lord. Amen. And that's what it takes. It takes us to come to a place where we say, literally, it's not about me. Whatever God wants, this is what he requires. Now, let's just be honest one more time. This must be the work of the Holy Spirit. So why is it important that we don't grieve him? Why is it important that we don't quench it? Because there's no way Jason Holly can do everything I just said unless the Holy Ghost is working in me. Ain't no way, friend. Amen, right? Ain't no way. I mean, I'm almost perfect, but my wife knows I'm missing that one little step. Praise the Lord. Amen. And by the way, for all of you that are going to tell on me for the book report that I used to do, I've already told her. Oh, yeah, I already told her. So not only do you see what the Lord requires. Let me give you number 2. I'll finish quickly. What the Lord rewards. What the Lord rewards. In other words, what does he give? Notice in verse number 35, he says, but love ye your enemies and do good. Watch us now. And lend, hoping for nothing again, and your reward shall be great. Watch us now. And ye shall be the children of the highest. He says, when you do this, people look at you, they know that you belong to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That's the greatest reward you could ever have. Greatest reward. You ever had somebody look at you and say, oh, you must be so-and-so's kid. I bet I know who your mom and daddy is. You know, that's a great honor, as long as you ain't acting crazy, right? But that's a great honor. Right? But he says right here, the greatest reward that could be said if you do these things is that's a true child of God right there. That's a true Christian right there. The second thing is, notice if you will, in verse number 36 and 37. Be ye therefore merciful, as your Father also is merciful. Judge not, and ye shall not be judged. Condemn not, and ye shall not be condemned. Forgive, and it shall be forgiven. So notice he said, be merciful, judge as you want to be judged. In other words,
There is a righteous judgment, okay? I don't have time to be able to chase these trails. We preached through this and taught through this before. We understand there's a righteous judgment, okay? But what this is saying right here is don't be so quick to stereotype people. Amen. Listen, the only thing we all have in common, if you're saved tonight, is Jesus Christ. And we probably all wouldn't get along and think the same on everything. And I don't even care, and I'm not trying, I don't even care if you're Republican or Democrat. I don't care if you're a Yankee or you're a Southern. It makes no difference to me. The only thing that brings us all together is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. So the problem is what happens, we begin to judge, okay? We judge people. And we say, you know what? I was thinking about people who serve in different things. We judge them and say, well, you can't trust them. They always got a bad attitude. Well, have you ever stopped and thought for a second that maybe you just don't understand them? You know, I say this illustration all the time, but I remember when I was working in the public schools, and man, I mean, there's nothing that crawls all over me more for a school teacher to be able to say, they're just so disrespectful. And I'm thinking to myself, well, whose job is it to make them respectful when they're sitting in school? It's not the kid's fault. It's the teacher's fault. I understand it goes back to the home, but y'all understand what I'm trying to say. The boundaries are set in that classroom by that teacher. So what they do is they want to stereotype. They want to judge this kid, and that kid will stay in that attitude problem all year long simply because of the way it started off. When she never for the first part thought maybe there's an attitude because they're just used to controlling everything. They don't have it their way. And maybe the reason why they're always mad that they don't get to be able to come to school and be here on time and you always give them a tardy slip is because they're the older brother and sister and they ain't got a good daddy or mama at home that takes their kids to school. So they have to be the responsible child to be able to take them, so they get their kids, because if they didn't do that, mom and dad's too sorry to be able to get them to school on time, and they come over here, they're trying to do everything they can, and all they're told is they got a bad attitude, and you don't know that really they're bitter because they got a mom and dad that's not being a mom and dad at home. Amen. And it goes beyond these things. You know, we look at them and say, well, they're just, you know, you can't never trust them. They're going to leave out of here. Or, you know, they'll come to church. Well, they've run to this church and they've run to that church. Well, have you ever slowed down instead of judging them and maybe just thought for the first second? Maybe they dealt with abandonment issues when they were younger. Maybe they don't know what it's like. And they get scared when they get close to somebody and they love somebody and then somebody leaves in their life. So then when they start feeling pressure, they get up and they leave and go somewhere else. But instead of doing that, we judge them. What the Bible's saying is, look. When you judge them, you ought to look at them like Jesus looked at you and realize that there may be something in your life a lot of people don't see. But at the end of the day, if you'll do what we said in all those first verses, you may actually be able to minister to those people before you judge those people. Amen. Amen. And then we say things like this, well, I want God to use me. Do you? Or you want to be seen? You want to be seen, I understand that, but man, if you want to be used, I mean, there's some rough people out in this world. There's some rough people in the church. Yeah, amen, I'm glad somebody said that. There is some rough people in the church. Like, they good and stuff, but like, when the South Side come out in them, it's rough up in here, right? Amen. Notice what he says. Forgive. Mercy leads to forgiveness. Oh, what a deep well. No way to be able to say it. No way to be able to explain it. No way to be able to give you enough scripture on it. Forgive. Forgive. Why? Notice what he says. Forgive and ye shall be forgiven. You know, sometimes people have such an agenda. They have no mercy. Until God, unfortunately, has to do something in their family to teach them mercy. Amen. I've been in it long enough. Listen,
They don't want to give no forgiveness until they've done something to somebody in their family, and you see the desperation in your husband or your wife or your children or your parents or somebody you love. They're trying so desperately to be able to seek out forgiveness and repent, and then there's not there. And then you realize just how much forgiveness really means because somebody allowed you close to you to be hurt by this. This is what God's saying. And I'll be honest with you, as a church, this is why I function by the grace of God. The Holy Spirit's got to do it, I can promise. You know, people want to be heard. I'm okay with that. Everybody's got problems, legitimate problems. Praise the Lord for that. But at the end of the day, you got to look at, I'm talking about two grown men, two grown ladies. And say, at the end of the day, what do you want? You want God to get the glory, or y'all want to be right? Well, I want to figure out the details. Okay, well, we can figure out the details. But at the end of the story, are we just trying to prove she's right or she's wrong or he's wrong or she's wrong, whatever it may be, and you're right or they're... I mean, what's really your agenda? Amen. Because it's the culture. You don't think it matters? Go ask the teenagers. Teenagers don't forgive. I mean, they do, but you understand what I'm saying? Typically, it's habits in the household. There's no consistency. Sometimes it's habits in the household. Amen. The runners. It's dysfunctional because they've been raised dysfunctionally. They don't know anything. They don't know what the Bible says. They've been taught, listen to me, they've been taught that it's okay in mom and dad. And when they get to be older, they'll just understand. So then they get this distorted view. And then you wonder why in the world when they get older and they go through, literally, forgive me for saying it this way, they literally go through hell on earth. They go through so many different trials and tribulations and things that happen because they were raised with this mindset, well, you know, it's okay, it's no big deal. But you never could say it's what the Bible says. And then when they get older and like, we call ourselves Christians and you did this, but this is what the Bible says. So what makes me have to live by the Bible? We're creating our own problems. If we want a forgiving generation, listen, you understand that's the whole purpose of be fruitful, replenish the earth, you know, multiply. It's to be able to take us and be able to have, you say it's a tough day to be living in. This ain't the time to stop having babies. This is a time to have babies and teach them what the Bible says. Let them grow up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, balanced. And let them make a difference for the glory of God. And they're not a Bible thumper. And they're not they're not washing the Word of God down. No, they're real. They're genuine. They actually love Jesus. And they look like us and act like us and they talk like us. And, you know, it ain't about our four and no more and our way and that's the only way. No, we need balanced people. You know, I'm going to lose some of y'all right here, but yeah, I'm sorry my son has a mullet and he's not bald-headed and short-haired like some of y'all's kids. But I'm proud of him. You know? And I would rather him treat your kids with respect and dignity and love them. No, he's not perfect. But I want him to love Jesus. If all I do is say, well, you need to dress like Brother Tim, or you need to dress like Brother Wayne, or son, you need to cut your hair, don't you understand? And then all of a sudden, whenever Brother Tim or Brother Wayne makes him mad, and then he gets rebellious and he walks away because I made him look to a man instead of a God. Y'all help me now. See, it's easy to talk about with the public things, but what about the things that nobody sees? The bitterness, the anger. And if you don't really know, record the way you talk in your home. You can tell, you won't want to listen to it sometimes. Because you can tell what you sound like when you're speaking. And you want to know why our kids act that way, why they turn that way, why they speak that way, they respond that way. Why they're so mad, why they're so frustrated, so confused. If you and I had to listen to everything they listened to, would we want to serve Jesus? Would we want to go to church? I'm gonna say something. Would we have the same preaching heroes that we have? Amen.
Amen. You know, I know people get up and preach against movies. If you're against movies, it's all right. I'll be honest with you. I'd rather my son sit down. I was watching that movie Hook. Y'all ever watch Peter Pan? I love that movie. He's like, Peter, it really is you. You know, I'm like, Panda Man. They're like throwing the fake stuff. It's Hook, 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 Hook. You know. Yeah, I love it, man. I love it. Now, I will say this. Back when I was young, you had to have an 18-year-old or parent buy you some of the music they listen to today on the radio. Things change, okay? But you can't just put everything in a box and say you're going to die and go to hell when you're not teaching about the principle. You know what I'm trying to say? Anyway, praise the Lord. Verse 38, I'm going to hurry. I'm trying to tell you, it's deep. It's a lot. But this is how people see Jesus. God said, I can bless you. I got to hurry. Verse 38, give and it shall be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet withal, ye shall be measured to you again. So this is what he's saying. He says, when you give, we're not just talking about your money. We're not just talking about an offering. But the way you live, your life itself, everything, the Lord's reward will be given back to you. And not only is it given back, it'll be running over. You'll be able to look at your children and say, boy, what a joy it was to be able to raise that child. You understand what I'm saying by that? You say, how does that happen? I kept him straight. I made him walk a straight line. No, that was the Lord blessing you for you yielding to God and doing everything God told you to. It was the Lord who did that. Amen. It's the Lord who did it. It wasn't you. It wasn't you being strict. It wasn't you turning off. Some people's against I Love Lucy. And I understand I Love Lucy a little crazy if you understand the whole story behind it, okay? But, man, it's a lot better off of some of the things we see on TV today. I done lost y'all because I'm preaching on TVs and telling y'all, you know, it's okay. You know, it's fine. I mean, you know, hey, now y'all might lose your really right here, but I'm going to tell you this because it's okay. Bobby Robertson made this comment one time. I'm not promoting. I'm not saying anything. I'm just telling you, and I quote. Bobby Robertson said, I'd rather a man smoke a cigarette, blowing smoke in somebody's face, telling them about Jesus, than to never tell anybody about Jesus at all. I hate to tell y'all, but R.J. Reynolds built a lot of these churches. So if you're going to boycott, you might as well walk out. I'm not being mean. I'm just being honest with you. Goes back to judging. Be careful, friend. Be careful. Boy, this ain't going to get a lot of likes on YouTube channel preaching, is it? But, you know, and here's the sad thing. Can I say this real quick? I'll have hard people say something, and then I'll have other people that is just completely loose, you know, that don't want to hear truth about forgiveness and living right and doing what the Bible says. You'll have both sides getting mad because the truth separates everybody. You know what I'm saying? You can't add to the truth, and you can't take it away. Some people's like, well, I'd rather be harder than that. No, if you add to it, it's not truth. God don't need your help. Amen. Anyhow, let me give you the third thing, and I'm done. Right, who's playing piano? Miss Taylor, won't you come on? Leave your Bible open real quick. So we see what the Lord rewards. All right, but then I want you to see this, what the Lord reveals, and I'm done very quickly. Notice what the Bible says, verse number 39. He says, and he spake a parable to them, can the blind lead the blind? Shall they not both fall into a ditch? What he's saying is God's saying, listen, if you'll do this, I'll give you vision. If you'll do this, I'll give you vision. I'll help you see. I'll help you be able to go. Listen. If we sit around wondering who's going to do it, I'm going to help you get through this, and I'm going to bless you. People may never understand it, but when you give, and when you give your life, and you give everything, you give by faith, you give by faith, you give by faith. So you're not blind. You're living by faith. And as you do that, God says, listen, if you sit around wondering how it's going to make sense, it's never going to make sense because only God gives the increase in the blessing. So we don't need the blind leading the blind. We need somebody to live what the Bible says. So he says, I give you vision. And then he says this too. Notice, He says that when you do it, you can tell. He reveals what kind of fruit it is. Verse number 40 and 41, I like how he says this. He says, the disciple is not above his master, but everyone that is perfect shall be as his master. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye? Watchest thou, but perceivest not the beam that is in thine own eye. In other words, you know, it's amazing how all you do is see the wrong in everybody else, but you don't see the wrong in yourself. I can promise you, if you and I get busy doing those first few verses, we ain't going to have time finding somebody else's faults. Just keep working on me. Amen. And you want to know what else it makes you do? It makes you be more merciful because you realize God's giving you mercy. You're like, Lord's going to put up with me. I need to put up with them. That ain't nothing compared to what I do. Amen. Listen, my wife, man, I'm telling you, she is a pistol when she gets emotionally driven. But she is the most pure, loving, genuine. And sometimes, man, I can get up there and I could just say things and be like, Tiffany, blah, 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 you should be acting like this. And, you know, and sometimes I'm, it's not a screaming thing, but I can usually speak it, but at the end of the day, listen, God uses her to balance me, and God uses me to be able to balance her. And the more that we work on ourselves, the more I realize we just keep getting stronger. Remember that triangle, Brother Larry, when we had that marriage counseling before we got married? You say, well, if you get closer to God and she gets closer to God, then what happens is we both get closer to each other. I know everybody in the world's probably seen that. But that helped me. It helped me. So look at yourself. Notice what he says after that, verse number 42. Either how canst thou say to thy brother, brother, let me pull out the mote that is in thine own eye, when thou thyself beholdest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Watch what he calls you, thou hypocrite. He said, if all you do is see everybody else's, but you don't see yourself, you're a hypocrite. Now, I don't know what kind of Bible you got, but if it's got red lettering, that's Jesus speaking. And can I say this? I know a lot of Christians that's been this way. I'm a preacher. I know a lot of preachers that we need to sit down on the first four pews and have somebody preach it to us, that verse right there. Y'all can say amen. We made of flesh just like you are. Always looking at somebody else, judging somebody else. You know, you remember the days where they didn't have Facebook, you didn't even know what nobody's church looked like until you went inside of it. Amen. Now, because you know what the inside looks like, they put something on there. 10 people got saved. Oh, they didn't get saved. You see what kind of church that is? Yeah. Amen. Oh, help me, Jesus. I meddled a lot tonight. He said, verse number 43, he said, a good tree produces good fruit. The bad tree produces bad fruit. And then lastly, notice 45 through 49, he just simply says, there's the requirement. What is it? He reveals there's something that you must do. Those who listen and those who don't, he will reveal it. Why? Because if you notice in verse number 48, what happens? There's a flood that arose. Did you notice that? You see that? The Bible says in verse 48, it says, there's a flood that arose and the stream beat vehemently upon the house. Verse number 49, notice this. It says, upon the earth against the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell. So both of them had a storm who came. But what's going to be revealed is who really did what God said and who did not do what God said. You can't expect the blessing and the goodness of God unless you do it God's way. Stewardship. I know I meddle a lot, I'm sorry, but that's convicting to me. That's a good reminder right there. Can I get amen? That was 7:57, so this is what we're going to do. I don't know, just heads bowed and eyes closed. I did this past week. I don't know why I've gotten in the habit of this. you sit there and draw a circle around your heart tonight? Lord, is there something I could be better? Right spirit, right attitude, right words. Lord, I want a blessed home. I want a blessed marriage. Well, you can't go back and live yesterday, but you can sit down with your family tonight and say, listen, I want to tell you I'm sorry. God showed me some things I need to work on, and I want to be better. I want to be a better Christian. Maybe tonight you're held up on those enemies that hurt you. The tragedy is they might not even go to church with you no more, and they're still holding you captive. God says, I'm going to give you liberty over that, but you got to forgive even though they're not sitting with you. You got to let that go. You got to let that go. You say, why does it matter? Because the greatest reward that he gives is when people look at you, they realize you're not like those normal Christians. You really are a child of God. There's something different about you. Heavenly Father.
It is a joy and a privilege to be able to know that you've tuned in, and I pray that today that the word of God that was shared will be a blessing to you. If somehow, some way that the Lord has spoke to your heart, and maybe you're sitting where you are and you don't know for sure that you're saved by the grace of God, and you've ever trusted Jesus Christ as a personal Savior, then I want you to know that the word of God says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible makes it very plain, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. You say, how do I get saved? You have to trust in Christ and Christ alone. Repent of your sin and then know, as the Bible says, where Jesus says, I am the way. And I pray that today that will be your desire to be able to seek out for the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to trust him as a Lord and Savior. If you do that today and you repent of your sins and you take him as your Savior, would you do us a favor and contact our church office at 336-788-0551? We would love to be able to speak with you. We would love to be able to encourage you, maybe be able to help you find a local church no matter where you are today, and maybe even possibly disciple you. So we want to say thank you so much, and we are definitely going to be praying for you and this ministry that our church has. If you know you're saved and maybe the Lord spoke to you in a different way and there's something heavy on your heart, again, that same number, if you can contact us, we'll be so thankful to be able to reach out and be able to speak with you. But again, on behalf of the church and myself, thank you so much, and may God bless you.